Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to introduce our moderator for the Davos of Human Capital 2020, Iman Rapetti.
In this extraordinary year of change and challenge, we are so excited to bring you a truly global conversation themed Leadership for a Better World. It is going to be real, reflective, and empowering. Last year at the Davos of Human Capital, we had hundreds of leaders with us face to face. And this year, we are joined by thousands more across the globe virtually. And by last count, I'm told, we are in excess of 6,000 global citizens and leaders joining us. And that is extraordinary and just delicious. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation. I'm broadcaster and author Iman Rapetti, joining you here from Johannesburg, South Africa, for what promises to be a glorious and inspirational 2 hours of discussion. Joining us now from London is President of Global Markets for Duke Corporate Education, Shamla Chetty. Shamla is someone who doesn't like the big titles and the big introductions, but I would like to let you know that she is the visionary behind the Davos of Human Capital and Million Young Minds. This is the youth program that introduced the world's first humanoid citizen, Sophia, to over 11 million young people on the African continent in 2019. Known as a nonconformist, Shamla is exceptionally passionate about growing the pipeline of female leaders across the African continent and the world. Shamla, it's over to you.
Very kind introduction. Welcome to everyone joining us today. When we started the Davos of Human Capital a few years ago, we understood the importance of leadership, but we did not imagine that this would become so critically important to our entire planet as it is right now. COVID-19 has been a reality check for humankind, sadly costing lives and livelihood. It has disrupted our way of working as well as our relationships, both personal and professional. It has left us all uncertain about the future. COVID-19 is a reminder that change happens, disruption happens, crises happen. There is no easy route through this crisis. 2020 has been the most challenging year of our century. We all know this. What we do now, how we engage, and how radical our thinking will be will determine what happens next. Leadership matters more now than ever. As we connect today across the globe, each of us has a responsibility to help each other in new ways. And as we have to learn, we need to show care, be bold, show courage, so that we can build a better world. We have to reset our social values, which must lead to a more equitable tomorrow. It is people like you and I who will have to rebuild what is lost, that we can reset our future going forward. So for me, it's very important for us to think about what it is that we can do differently going forward.
Take a lot of inventive thinking on our part. Shamla, why the theme Leadership for a Better World?
The COVID-19 crisis have been amplified by the unequal society we all are in. The racial inequality, gender-based violence, and climate change remains. Leadership is about progress, and progress is best defined in its simplest form as improvement of people's lives. And as our Dean Bill Boulding will share, we have a crisis of leadership on hand. There is no leadership playbook right now. We will need to be open to new ideas, show courage, boldness, empathy, kindness to build the changes that are required going forward. We believe that leadership is a force multiplier for positive change. It has the power to shape and change business and society for the better. You will hear today from Professor Dan Ariely that we will need to change our behaviors to unlock humanity's great potential. So our duty as leaders is clear. How we approach this mission going forward will need to be explored further today with our great thought leadership.
Thank you so much, Shamla. I mean, I certainly can't wait to get into the program. It really is something to behold at this crucial time. These are important insights as we begin this most powerful conversation. And it's a reminder to all of you who are joining us today to share your thoughts as well in our chat box. And you can tweet us on that hashtag, the the hashtag Davos Human Capital. So we've got an amazing lineup of speakers for you today. You can cast your eye over the program to see the names of the CEOs and the experts from across the globe that are gathering around this fire to help us all make sense and decide who we are becoming in this moment in history, because we are interconnected more than we previously thought we were. Our actions and our responses have deep impact on our global family. So while it's important to focus on ourselves as individuals, on ourselves as leaders, we have to recognize that we are only single strands in this bigger human tapestry. And as Bill Boulding will share, now more than ever, business is the place where we can come together to advance the common good. William Boulding is the Dean and J.B. Fuqua Professor of Business Administration at the Fuqua School of Business, Duke University. And his CV, I can tell you, is an impressive read of accomplishments in strategy, ethics, and leadership. Today, he kicks off our program with a focus on the new imperative, business as a force for good. And it fits in so perfectly with this tone that Shamla has just set. How business behaves in real and sincere ways will define how our world responds. Bill, welcome to the program, and so great to have you with us today.
Thank you, and thank all of you for the privilege of joining you wherever you are in the world. I hope this day finds you and your families well. That's certainly not something we can take for granted. If I could start with the obvious, we are living in terrible, terrible times. But to foreshadow my message, this is our time to shine. This is when we can make our organizations better while doing what's best for society. And so if I can go back to the obvious, a crisis is a crisis, but what makes this an unprecedented time is the fact that we have four simultaneous crises. The first three are obvious. We have a health crisis, a public health crisis that is unprecedented for our lifetimes, an economic crisis, and what I'll call a crisis of values, which is playing out in different ways around the world. In this part of the world, it's playing out as a crisis around a broken social contract, and therefore a crisis around racial equity and justice. In the face of these crises, people are naturally scared, anxious. They want to make sure that things are going to be okay, and they want to belong to something. On the other hand, if we look at how it is that we've actually responded in this crisis, what's interesting is to consider what we know about teams and in tough times, what happens to teams. And what we know is that when you have a good team, a crisis can make you more resilient, bring you together, and a bad team will fall apart. And the good versus bad outcome, what is the difference? The difference is, are you all on the same team? Or are there factions on that team where you start to point fingers at one another? And the real issue is, do we have common purpose? And now if you ask yourself, how have we responded to these three crises? What's really awful is we are not all on the same team. Rather, we have to look at these three crises in the context of the world we lived in pre-pandemic, which is to say, a world full of polarization, astonishingly, in the context of the pandemic, instead of pulling together to tackle these crises and being on the same team, rather what's happened is these crises have been politicized and we aren't therefore solving these crises. We are in fact creating a fourth crisis, which is a crisis of leadership, which is where all of you come in. This is your time. The world needs your leadership now more than ever. And here is the good news, which is as the world loses faith in the institutions and the leaders who we would normally expect to solve the kinds of crises we're facing, increasingly people are looking to the business community and the platform of business to solve these challenges. And so in the context of the 2008 global financial crisis, what's interesting is at that time, business was viewed as the cause of these problems. But now in the context of the current pandemic, we are being looked to for solutions. We are actually the most trusted institution when people are asked, who do you want to turn to for advice around your health? we are the most trusted institution in terms of responding to racial injustice. It's my employer that people are looking to. But this expectation that business will solve societal problems makes the leadership challenge more complicated for all of you. And your stakeholders are going to demand that you step forward on issues that are outside of your traditional business domain. And so the question is that everyone has to confront on a frequent basis is, when do you weigh in and how do you weigh in on these societal challenges? And if I could be so presumptuous, what I would tell you is to know when you will stand up, you need to know what you stand for. And to make that a little more concrete, let me tell you what it is that we stand for. And it's very simple, three things. The first one is we think that business must be used as a force for good, that given that business provides this platform to drive change in society, we have a responsibility to use that in positive ways. Second thing we stand for is quite simple. A great team will beat a great individual. And as you ask the question of what makes a great team, you have to recognize that a great team requires diverse team members and that those people need to feel a sense of belonging on the team. And so you need to be in the game and on the team. Then the third thing that we stand for is that we believe it takes a special kind of leader to create a great team, and a very different kind of leader than what we've been observing in society, which is to say the following. I do not understand poetry, but I do understand something said by the poet Yeats. He said, talent perceives differences, genius unity. And unfortunately, we have a number of very talented people who are driving divisiveness in society. And what we need instead of polarization is we need the genius of unity. And in our view, that takes a special kind of leader. It takes someone who has triple threat capability, the IQ to understand the very complicated world we live in, the EQ to relate to one another. If we believe, as we do, that a great team beats a great individual, you have to have the ability to relate effectively to others and work effectively with others. But perhaps the most important distinguishing characteristic we need in the world today is DQ, or a decency quotient. We need leaders who will value others, respect them, care for them, elevate them so they can bring their best and truly feel they belong on the team and will give their best to the team, and the humility to understand that others know more than we do and that we can learn important lessons from others. And so from our point of view, this makes our life very simple. We understand then when it is that we will choose to step up and step forward. When we see someone who is kept out of the game and off of the team, what we stand for compels us to act. And so we have made very public stands and commitments around issues like LGBT rights, gender equity, immigration, and racial equity and justice. What you stand for will determine when you and how you act. And that's up to you to figure out what you stand for. But you will and should be accountable for traditional measures of business performance, just as we are. But having said that, I passionately believe that business can be a force for good and that you can make your organizations better while doing what's best. Thank you, and please be well.
Thank you so much, Bill. The concept of common purpose, I think, is such a powerful, powerful one, and one that we are going to be teasing out and excavating throughout the course of our conversation, because it all comes back to that. Do we share a common purpose in a way that advances what is a positive agenda for the world that we're living in, especially in times of chaos and crises? So our next speaker had me at Back to the Future, because one of my most favorite movies of all time is the trilogy, which I've recently rewatched with my children. If only we had a doc and a DeLorean to help us go back in time to undo some of our mistakes. In the absence of that, we have to rely on people like Boston Consulting Group's New York MD and partner, Frank Breitling, because Frank and the folks at BCG's Global Leadership Team for People and Organizational Practice and BCG's Task Force for the Future of Work spend their time distilling lessons that help us go forward, that help us create a new balance between what customers and employees need. His talk, I know, is going to be an insightful deep dive into the enterprise of the future. Frank, it's over to you.
Thank you, Iman, for the kind introduction, and thank you everyone for joining. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are today. I'm very excited to be with you here today and share our perspectives on shaping the future of work. We believe it is a really important element to enable everything that Bill has been talking about, setting your organizations up to be stronger and better coming out of this crisis, making your engagement with your customers stronger, making your engagement with your employees stronger, and really define the future of working right now. First, on the next slide, we have to recognize that our past work models have been rooted in the Industrial Revolution, driven by standardization, scale, and control. Many of these work models have been, you know, refined and tweaked over time. Open plan offices, cubicle offices, back to open plan, new types of, you know, workspaces, but they were baby steps. Over the past 5 years, we have seen a dramatic shift driven by advancements in digital technologies, driving a completely different way of value creation, solution creation, driven by automation, personalization, virtualization, and much more. In line with that, customer expectations have shifted dramatically over the past 5 years, and employee expectations and behaviors have shifted as well. COVID has catapulted us into the future by accelerating all of these trends. We strongly believe that leaders must embrace these shifts and actively redesign the future of working in an intentional way to not only keep lockstep with the shifts, but actually get ahead of the curve and create competitive advantage. Next slide. Just to illustrate some of these shifts in numbers that have been triggered by the onset of the pandemic. In the US, in-store spending has dropped by 30%. At the same time, digital online spending by the same consumers has surged by 15 or 20%, making up for a big portion of it. At the same time, over the past 9 months, about 50% of B2B businesses have instituted new sales channels, new go-to-market approaches, and that is only in the last nine months. 50% are tapping into different ways to engage with their customers at scale. And at the same time, we heard from employees in this crisis that 60% say, like, well, part of the things that I get from remote working are actually good. 60% say, like, well, in the future, I want to actually hold on to flexibility in either when I work or where I work or both. And there's a strong emphasis on the when I work. It's not only the where I work that we need to look out for. And then a couple of numbers that are not here on the slide, but are really important. 75% of employees say they are as productive or more productive in the current remote environments that they find themselves in, with about 50% saying they are as or more productive even for collaborative tasks that we would say are the most difficult to replicate in new working models. So all of these shifts will remain. They will not be turning back, certainly not to where 2019 was. They are here to stay. And with that, we need to define the winning formula for the future of working. As you do so, take your customer preferences and needs into consideration as much as the employee needs and preferences. We strongly believe that you need to optimize for both of these constituencies and create the work that helps you engage with your customers in a different way, line up your employees with that work, and find the ways of working that make them most productive and serve their needs. We strongly believe that digital will play a tremendous role in that solutioning And we believe that the future work models will be hybrid models, and they will not be a single hybrid model, but a combination of differentiated hybrid models that are fit for purpose for the different activities that you need to pursue to serve your customers. So it's not all remote, but it's not all back in person, but it's deliberately designed in a hybrid model. Next page. As you're defining the value that can be created from these new ways of working, next slide, please. We urge you to define the value at stake very holistically. Well, one slide back, actually. It is important to not look only at the customer, the revenue side. It's certainly important not to look only at the, you know, cost equation, the real estate side, but look at the full spectrum of upsides and downsides that might exist around revenue, the physical space, your employees, their well-being, the sustainability, and your impact on society. Many of these aspects will be either risks or they will be opportunities. Be very deliberate to look at the value map holistically, identify the risks and mitigate them, and look for the opportunities that can create competitive advantage. It is critically important to understand that you cannot wait to see how this plays out. Waiting is standing still, and standing still in this environment is falling behind. There is tremendous, tremendous opportunity cost of inaction as the markets, both around customers and talent, are being shaped right now around you. You have to act and create with deliberation right now. Consequently, as you're shaping the future of working, you need to take as well a holistic approach to how you go about it. It's critically important to define how we work in the future and embrace disruption on the customer side, on the employee side, and in turn on the productivity side. On the very right-hand side of this slide, it's also very important to think about, you know, what we need to enable the workforce of the future in terms of space, in terms of technology, in terms of tools, and in terms of learning. There's a big block in the middle that many don't have fully on the radar yet, because we are dealing with so many things about, like, how do we get people safely back into an office? How do we get them back safely to a production site? And we are just, now in the second wave. So lots of things in the right now that need to be dealt with. But the opportunity, as you're harnessing it, lies very much as well in the middle, in the how we lead and how we organize. In the end, working differently will require different work models, might require different teams, might accelerate agile at scale deployment, might break down silos in functions and, you know, lead to more cross-functional collaboration that can be easier, like in remote or hybrid work models, and will be more important to innovate as you're going forward. And very critically important, how we lead. Your leaders need to be equipped to empower their teams and inspire their teams through the crisis and beyond. That requires training and investment into your leaders, and it requires training and investment into your teams. This is a big canvas, and I know it can be overwhelming. It is very overwhelming for our clients to think about this. And at the same time, everyone agrees this is ultimately what we need to tackle. Many start with, you know, one or two entry points and start the journey there. And that is right to make it manageable. But in the end, you need to evolve the whole system that your organization and your environment are to harness really like the power and the opportunity from the future of working, the future of working differently than in the past and in the right now. As I come to a close, I want to leave you with five key messages to take home. Number one, embrace the change and act with conviction. The change is here to stay or will further accelerate. So take it as an opportunity, not only as a risk mitigation impetus. Secondly, be holistic in your aperture as you're thinking about creating competitive advantage. Thirdly, start with your customer. Your organizations exist because you are serving your customer in a differentiated way. So find new ways of staying at the cutting edge of serving them or others will. Start with the customers. But don't have the employees, number four, as an afterthought. The employees are in the middle of it, and they will make you successful as you're going forward. Therefore, elevate your employees, make them part of the journey, harness their ingenuity in ways of working and creating new solutions for your companies and for your customers. Make them deliberate part of the journey and bring them along. And number five, act now. The opportunity cost of an action, as I said, is tremendous. You cannot stand still. You have to shape the future. The future is now, and it is up to you to take it into your hands to shape the future. Thank you.
Frank, thank you. I totally enjoyed listening to you. And I think I personally really appreciate the notion of no going back to the old days and the old ways. I was reading a really interesting article in Bloomberg just the other day about digital nomads and how different countries are fighting to hold on to people that are essentially nomadic in the world and are able to do their work from home. I know it's a privilege that is ascribed to a limited few, but if we can truly achieve a world where there is a real work-life balance, where everything is in a kind of equilibrium, what a wonderful aspiration to have. So thank you very much for that riveting talk. I know that some of you might not have been able to see the slide deck, and we will make sure that it gets to you. So you can certainly find it on Duke CE's website after the conference is over. So we've taken you to the heart of the enterprise with Bill. We have shown you a glimpse of the future with Frank. Let's buckle up now for a pacey discussion with some of the world's most respected CEOs. And this robust will be chaired by Duke Corporate Education CEO Michael Chavez, who will crack open the strategies for change that frontline leaders had to grapple with and overcome during this massive health event. Michael, it's so wonderful to see you again. A year ago at Davos, you shared your perspective on purpose-driven leadership, and there is no more apt a time in the world than right now to use that as a light for the uncertain path ahead.
It's great to see you too, Iman. I had a great time last year, and I'm delighted that we're together this year. You know, last year we talked a lot about the importance of shared purpose and shared clarity and how that creates a way for companies to navigate through uncertainty. Little did we know how prophetic that conversation would be. But we talked about this idea of institutional logic versus economic logic. Economic logic is what I call the right to survive. Institutional logic is the right to thrive, the right to flourish over time with people and with society. And so I think this is one of the things that's really setting us up for this conversation.
Absolutely. As you mentioned, and I think before we go into your panel, Michael, and pardon my enthusiasm, everyone, but I have seen, the kind of fast forward picture to what we're expecting today. And it really is so insightful and so apt for this moment in our history right now. So I want to play a clip of one of our clients, Ken Frazier, who is the CEO of Merck. That's the global pharmaceutical company known as MSD just outside of the U.S.
And as Merck's CEO, I can bring opportunities to others by guiding the company to promote economic inclusion and social justice in all of our undertakings. Success requires moral leadership, people with vision who are guided by sound values, who can make principled decisions for the greater good, even if these decisions are economically or politically unpopular. We need leaders like my CEO predecessors at Merck, who put patients before profits and established a company committed to saving and improving lives.
How's that for a setup, to a panel, Michael?
Couldn't be a better setup for our conversation today, because, you know, the panel today, we're gonna talk about the leaders' sort of strategies for coping with a lot of things we often don't get a chance to talk about. Things like building resilient organizations, creating trust, building the ability to navigate uncertainty. And I think this is exactly what Ken is sort of highlighting here, is this ability to build resilient organizations by thinking beyond simply the economic logic of a company, going into this broader institutional logic. What is it that allows me to thrive over time, even if it causes some unpopular trade-offs in the short run? These are becoming more and more critical questions. Now, before I introduce our global leaders today, I want to ask a poll question, if that's okay. We're going to do a quick poll. And here's the question. given the experience of the health, economic, and social crises that we've been facing globally, which do you think should be at the top of the priority list for your CEO, managing director, or business leader in the year ahead? Number one, pivoting to entirely new business models. Two, reinforcing and strengthening existing business models. Three, leading the digital transformation of your business. Or four, building a culture of purpose, empathy, and trust. And we'd like to enter your response now. We'd love to see what you say. This is really exciting that we have so many people joining today. And so just enter your response in the sidebar polls and we'll see what comes up. There's the question. While we're waiting for the polls to come in, Iman, you know, I love these questions because I think that I'm sure they're all really important. I mean, we've got to sort of do all of, perhaps all of them, but some are starting to become reprioritized with all the uncertainty that we've been dealing with. And that's what I think is what's interesting about what's going on. Most CEOs today are that we talk to are having, you know, this reprioritization effort that's going on within their businesses. And it involves not just their business models, but also how they're thinking about their culture.
I love number four, Michael. If I was participating in the poll, I would talk about this culture of empathy and purpose. Isn't it so amazing that in this context, we're not just one-dimensional workers of the kind that Frank was talking about at the end or the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, where we're just kind of pigeonholed into our roles, plucked the cards and left. Organizations are far more holistic and need to be to survive.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's sort of been on our agenda for the last 20 or 30 years, kind of in discussion. But now what's happening is we're finding it to be a point of urgency for a lot of reasons, but not least of which the whole model for how we collaborate is different. We have to collaborate across boundaries much more. We have to collaborate against completely, totally unknown problems. I was with a client yesterday and they were just talking about the fact that the transformation they're going through has never been done before by anyone. So there's no models. So we have to rely on some of these bigger levers to try to make these kinds of transformations.
We're certainly living in an exam room. I wonder how we're doing on the results. Remember, there are almost 6,000 people, as we said earlier, joining us. So get those fingers clicking, make your selection so that we can give this result of how you felt around this question that Michael's just posed to you.
While we're doing that, even the way we conceived of some of these questions have changed somewhat in the last week, right? We've had, and I know we'll talk about this with Priya in a little bit, but it's fascinating to see what's happened with respect to the COVID vaccines, coming out with secondary data on all of them. Fascinating and hopeful.
I think we have some coming in, Michael. So I think the team's telling us ways to share. So let's go ahead.
Great. Is it coming up?
All right. So I've got on question one, Mike, 67% selected the first option of building a culture of, or the option of building a culture of empathy.
But it 60%. Seems that number four. That's the winner.
Yeah. Number four. So that's the outright winner. I know can't see the results there. Go ahead, Mike.
No, maybe you could read out the percentages for each of the questions.
Okay, so 3.9% selected the pivoting to an entirely different business model. And I'm sure that a lot of, you know, business institutions had their hands full over the last few months thinking about which is the right way to go. But only 3.9% selected that. 2% selected leading the digital transformation. Only 6% as well selected reinforcing and strengthening existing business. The overwhelming front runner was actually my selection, building a culture of empathy and your favorite school of thinking, Michael, purpose.
Yeah, indeed. Well, you know, it's interesting because I suspect one of the things that's going on is 1, 2, and 3, the first three, a lot of that has already been happening, right? A lot of businesses were already pivoting business models, going through digital transformation, et cetera. So I think the next sort of the undiscovered country for all of us is really working on our culture, building an empathy, not just because it's nice, but because we need to collaborate at a completely different level. So with that, I think it would be really good for us to introduce our poll, our panel. We've brought together a great group of individuals from key industries for our conversation today, who bring critical insights into these kinds of questions around culture, collaboration, trust, and also rethinking the private sector's role in the transformation that we're going through as a society. And dealing with that all in the context of sudden change. So first of all, let me introduce Adrian Gore from Discovery. He founded Discovery in 1992 with a core purpose to make people healthier and enhance and protect their lives. Discovery is now a multinational financial services group, partnering with leading insurers over 23 markets and covering 20 million lives. Their behavior change model, Vitality, translates healthy behavior into financial services pricing, which is not only transforming markets, but is making insured populations healthier, which is really exciting. So welcome, Adrian. Glad to have you on the panel. Next we have, you know, as I mentioned, Dr. Priya Agrawal from Merck or MSD. As we've been wrestling with COVID, the COVID outbreak, and dealing with sustainability and how to respond to it, it's great to have your voice in the room. Priya was previously the executive director for vaccines and women's health at MSD in the UK, and formerly launched and led MSD for Mothers, which was a $500 million global initiative. And that one had the effect of reducing maternal mortality. She's passionate about ensuring early access to innovative medicines and vaccines. And my good friend Rungrot Rongseo Pash is also joining us here from Siam Cement, from SCG Group, which is the leading business conglomerate in ASEAN in Southeast Asia. And SCG has really committed themselves to transformation over the years that I've known Rungrot and his team, around three core businesses: cement, building materials, and chemicals and packaging. And in line with really good corporate governance and sustainable development principles through its 107-year history. Rungrot's key strategies, in addition to creating this innovative business against a fairly traditional business backdrop, has to do with fostering forward-thinking teamwork, supporting progressive changes, and encouraging creative confidence among its 51,000 employees to add value and stimulate growth. So we've got a great group with great perspectives. Thank you all so much for joining us today. I'd like to start, Priya, with you, if that's okay. You know, Bill talked about how interconnected everything is, and we're seeing that really starkly right now. We never thought we would. The industry are working very closely together now, and we're seeing that in relief as it's happening. What do you see as the private sector's role, and maybe even obligation, at this moment, in helping to transform society?
Yeah, thank you, Michael. So there's actually a fundamental irony right now. Yes, it is true that COVID is highlighting how we as citizens of a global society are both interconnected and actually interdependent. No one is safe until all of us are safe. But we cannot underestimate the societal rot that has been developing in recent years of increasing polarization and the growing us versus them phenomenon. It doesn't matter whether it's country versus another country, black versus white, poor versus rich. At every level, it's fast becoming a sort of global security threat. And so what you heard Ken, our global CEO, say about moral leadership in that clip is actually especially critical amongst private sector leaders like you have on this panel, if we're going to fulfill our duty and role in society to actually restore social justice. So we're not as old as SDG, but for 125 years, we've been conscious about creating both shareholder value and stakeholder value. And it's important for that to be in our actions and our words. So whether it's speaking against recent injustices in America or driving economic inclusion via commitment to the Black Empowerment Agenda in South Africa, we really have an important role to improve the society in which we belong. That's 140 countries for us, where we work, we're members of, we create jobs, we're friends in. And you can't actually do that unless you're only focused on maximizing profits. I think what Bill Balding said is very important, right? Private sector brings people of different backgrounds and beliefs together. And that's actually really powerful, increasing empathy and understanding, which in turn starts to heal the divisiveness from the bottom up. Now, you chose a very timely example when you said COVID vaccines. I think it's a great example of how we as an industry are really walking the talk of actually unprecedented collaboration amongst competitors for the common good. But we can do more. Society needs unprecedented, transparent communication to address the ever-growing and highly concerning issue of vaccine hesitancy. The root cause of hesitancy is deep. It's a mistrust of science, of truth, of institutions, and that risks our democracy. But I think while we're making a painstaking traditional effort to assure quality, safety, and efficacy, and yet working at very non-traditional speeds, we have an opportunity to contribute to societal trust in the truth in a fundamentally different way. So yes, absolutely we play a role when it comes to transforming society.
And you mentioned this transformation. I'd like to get your quick take on how you increase the speed of this transformation. How are you seeing Merck and MSD kind of respond to just dial up the speed? Because that's really what everyone seems to be doing, right?
So, Mike, I'm actually going to take a slightly controversial, perhaps more interesting stance on this. I think every leader right now is going to talk about the normal transformation, digital, process, making sure your business reflects the society in which you operate in. But if you've watched the Netflix docufilms, either Social Dilemma or The Great Hack, they are caution stories of not moving without taking your partners with you. Right, so we're seeing warp speed transformation of big data and social media, the negative impact of tech companies transforming ahead of the regulatory authorities. And if we do that with the COVID vaccine, we're in trouble. I'm just going to quickly share an example of hope. MSD discovered and developed the world's first Ebola vaccine at a speed so it could be available during the very first crisis without compromising safety, quality, and efficacy. But there's no way that would have happened if the academic partners hadn't transformed how trials work, if WHO hadn't allowed for a simultaneous single regulatory process, and if we hadn't educated civil society, because vaccines don't save lives, vaccinations do. So my answer to your question about transformation was be careful, take people with you, otherwise we're gonna also be the subject of a Netflix docufilm.
It's a great point, right? This idea that we can't just think about sheer speed. We have to think about interconnectedness, getting back to Bill's point, this idea of interconnectedness, bringing those partners with us. Adrian, I'd love to turn it to you and ask you sort of the similar question about the role of the private sector in society from your perspective, from Discovery's perspective.
Well, Michael, I think the private sector has a massive obligation to transform society. And then secondly, maybe to an earlier point, I think that doing it is not at the cost of success or thriving, as you put it. I think if you really are transforming society for the good, you will thrive. I think that's just how society is today. I guess our story is an interesting one. No hubris here at all, but I think, we started out as starting up a health insurer in South Africa just as apartheid was ending. So this was a country in real complex, painful transformation from a very bad regime to a democratic one. And how do you build a health insurer in a place where you've got too few doctors, terrible levels of disease, and a determination of government, of new government, to have an egalitarian, like Obama, no pre-existing exclusions, no risk rating, etc. And we had this kind of almost entrepreneurial hunch, let's incentivize people to be healthier, almost kind of infantile idea, but it took us on the most remarkable, amazing journey. you know, of kind of understanding behavioral issues, behavioral science, how this can affect actuarial factors in insurance. And to an extent, we kind of settle on this purpose of make people healthier, real authentic stuff that has carried us forward. And it's been our North Star from the start. And, you know, the kind of three trends of the nature of risk being behavioral, the power of technology, and the importance of corporate purpose were always kind of our took us from a local South African startup to a global institution. But what's amazing is the COVID pandemic has just accentuated that stuff. And the issue of corporate purpose has let us see that our kind of shared value model, where we are sharing value with customers, when they're healthier, we're more profitable. So it's a fascinating business. And I hope I'm not being patronizing talking about our business, but it's a fascinating business in the sense that we're the only actors, I think, out there that when people are healthier, we monetize that effect. It's a wonderful thing, you know. So we are completely and totally aligned to our customers. So it's given us the opportunity to create a shared value financial services model, and one that is, I think, can change the world. You know, we're working with some of the biggest insurers and financial services companies globally. So we have seen the kind of power of what the private sector can do. And I guess maybe my insight, if there's one lesson I've learned, we've been quite lucky, is the if your model is completely aligned to the good of society, whatever you do, then there's no dissonance. You know, then the issue of stakeholder capitalism there's no dissonance in that equation. You know, if you're doing something wrong by society, it's hard to thrive and do good at the same time. Yes. So my sense, I think that the private sector can and should play a massive role, but I think you do need to have a business, hopefully, that's good for society and align the two in an explicit way and be clear about it. So for us, I hope it's not a self-interested story, just giving a sense of our journey and one that I, you know, strongly believe is the right way.
Very inspiring to hear that. And I love what you said about being guided by purpose, because what that suggests is, I think that reinforces this idea that purpose always has to be both inside out and outside in. You can't just have one way or the other, right? It's always got to be about both, because we're players in society, and that's how we thrive, by making it good for society. But you also have this wonderful model where your entire business is built on improving health, which also is a rehumanization strategy, because you're moving people from thinking of customers as black boxes to actual people with, you know, with choices. And that's I think a great example of how this rehumanization can work in a very tangible way. And, you know, I also want to touch on this issue of your brand, because it's really built on trust, which has to flow from you, your leadership team, your organization, and your people. How has that been impacted in the last few months? I mean, I know this, you know, it's been a very tough time for a lot of CEOs because of, you know, many of us have had to lose some of our people. Some of us have had to have, you know, cut salaries, things like that. How have you grappled with this idea of trust as a core fundamental employee experience? And how do you build that within your organization?
Yeah, it's a great question. I mean, I guess as a financial services company, trust is typically about financial trust, that you'll be there to fulfill your financial obligations. And I think that is important. But, you know, our purpose of make people healthy has created a different obligation of being a force for good in society. And it's interesting. I think, you know, trust is about consistency. It's about authenticity. It's about something that's virtuous. You know, the intangible qualities. I think the test of trust is often during difficult times. And I would say during this COVID period, it's been quite fascinating. You know, we've done a lot of things for the communities we operate in. We worked with government on the track and trace app with Apple and Google. We've done a lot of stuff that I think has been visible. But the core of our strategy has been the concept of focusing on making people healthier and keeping our 12,000 people, our 12,000 employees consistently focused on that purpose. You know, so we've had them at home. We've had webinars, I think, like others have done, but we've done fun stuff around having Olympians do mad aerobic exercises, you know, with our executive team with thousands of people, you know, that kind of fun stuff. But we've kept a consistency of the issue of purpose. But one of the things I think that we've really done, a culmination, is really a reworking of our values. So we've never changed our values in literally 27 years. We did a rework of values, and we had a kind of a process of people involved to question the values and make a few changes. And we basically had a town hall meeting recently with our 2,000 leaders, and kind of laid out three or four simple changes to the values, but have hours of debate about this stuff. You know, so we almost didn't change the, we accentuated the purpose and the values through debate and just a constant process of how can I say, evolution. And the focus was on, you know, things like inclusion, of being proud of people's differences, sexual orientation, gender, race. If we celebrate people's differences, you know, focusing on, you know, empathy with customers, getting to really like our customers, focusing on, you know, integrity that make your mother proud or your parents proud. You know, simple, but really the point I'm making is going back to the values, not focusing on business and earnings per share and, you know, capital and liquidity and solvency, the kind of stuff you deal with in a pandemic as a financial services company, but focusing on purpose and values. And I think, I mean, I think ironically, although it's been a very difficult time for everyone, ironically, my sense is the organization is much more, immersed in the purpose and values. We did it, maybe something that's maybe too hard. We forced, not forced, let me say, we offered all of our people a chance to basically change their terms of employment to embrace the new values. In other words, it's in the employment contract. So symbolically, after this process, you were required to sign changing your terms, your conditions of employment to accept these new values. So there's symbolism, but there's something hard about it, you know. So sorry, I'm being verbose, but really trying to focus on trust, on embellishing the purpose and values without necessarily changing them, maybe is the point.
It's a beautiful example, because these things need reinforcement, right? They need, especially in context, like it, given what's been happening, to use this as a time to kind of go up and talk about these really high sort of holistic ideas that bring people together and that align people and get them into meaning, is an absolutely critical component. And on this question, Rungrot, I'd love to get your voice on in the conversation. You're president of CEO's largest industrial, you're the president and CEO of Thailand's largest industrial conglomerate. And, you know, you've got this issue of trust both nationally, but also with your employees. What can you say about how you build trust in your organization?
Well, thank you, Michael. I think, you know, one of the things that I recognize is that trust is something that takes some time. You know, you cannot just build trust in one day, you know, and trust cannot be built just only by communication. It has to be built by action. I think that's the way that I think, you know, walking the talk, you know, being consistent and being in line in terms of your values of the company and what your action is. For example, I just remember at the very beginning of this pandemic, back in February, you know, we have had people flying around the world. That was usual of our business. And then when those people are coming back, you know, that basically there are two camps of people. One that saying, well, you know, for those executives that fly in and out of the country, we're supposed to be quarantined and, you know, observing face mask, physical distancing, and so on and so forth. That was at the very beginning of this pandemic. On the other hand, you know, there are some very much senior executives who say, well, you know, this is nothing. You know, I mean, you know, all the rules apply to everyone except me.
Right.
So I guess, you know, one of the things that, you know, we did and we took immediate action is basically making an announcement, you know, having a town hall talk, you know, to both executive and also to all employees that, hey, you know, this thing is coming in, you know, it can be developed at that time to be a pandemic. And for us to fight this type of crisis, we need to make sure that there are some ground rules within our organizations in order to fight the crisis, which is basically respecting the others. Mm-hmm. You know, the rules we have to apply everyone. And the first rule that we have as a company is to respect people, believe in the value of individuals. And if you do so, believe in the value of individuals, you would respect, you know, the livelihood, the safety of the others' people as well. So, you know, once we had that kind of conversations and you know, we
we do it every week. You know, it's not really elegant speech or anything like that, but, you know, we substantiate it. And once you place that kind of values ahead of seniority, ahead of positions, ahead of, you know, even profit or continuity of the business, that's when people started to recognize that, hey, you know, this is something that for us is very important, for us as a company. And that's when people started, you know, to have a very strong, united way with, I think, you know, with a very strong urgencies of how to address the crisis. That's when, you know, I think as a company, the trust level started to show off.
Wonderful. Well, you know, that's a wonderful story, Rungro, because one of the things we found out, not surprisingly, in the research we did on purpose was just how it really is at these moments of being tested that things like purpose, values, vision really start to matter, and that that has the effect of building trust because people start to see it in action as a decision tool. You know, a lot of lot of things have changed. We've got an awful lot of things on our plates today as CEOs, managing directors, business leaders. And maybe Rungro, you can I could ask you a follow-up question to that, which is what advice do you have for the leaders attending today, especially given the learnings that you've had in the last, say, year? What advice do you have for leaders?
One of the things that I recognize that, you know, this kind of crisis can happen anytime. You know, and hopefully not, but, you know, we have to expect that at some point of time, this kind of once in a lifetime crisis will happen. How do you prepare organizations to address that? Mm-hmm. You know, how do we prepare ourselves to address that? You know, okay, doing this, the digitalizations, you know, business transformation, flexibility, customer centric, that's all help. But at the same time, you know, we also have to think that, well, as a company, what made us survive this crisis? Mm-hmm. And right. I believe that what made us survive the crisis is the people. When you have strong collaboration among the people, and when you have the common goal of people, so that the kind of force made us as a company to be able to execute our strategy, our survival, our adaptability, that's very important. So with that in mind, that's something that, you know, we started to instill, you know, this kind of culture, this kind of thinking that, you know, let's collaborate. Let's make sure that, you know, we address issues of stakeholders, we address issues of our purpose, we address issues of identifying what's important as an organization and try to make that in line with the values that people observe. I think that's important. And that's something that, you know, as a leader, I think it's important that, you know, the only legacies that you can leave with the company is to make sure that people behind you hopefully can have the kind of mindset to, you know, to face the crisis whenever that comes.
Marvelous. Thank you. Thank you so much, Rungro. It's very inspiring to hear that. Can ask for your answer to that question, just as a quick wrap up, what advice do you have?
Yeah, thank you, Michael. I think at the end of the day, focus on your people is not new advice. But I think when you're navigating a crisis and you're making a conscious choice between the well-being of your employees and business continuity, for us, you know, purpose is our patients, I had to choose. And so I chose my employees. With some trepidation, and it's meant we had zero supply issues, not one patient missed their dose on life-saving clinical trials, and we created more jobs while people were letting them go. And so the best advice I actually got was the best way to know if you can trust someone is trust them. And as a woman, I could not be working 8 to 5. I had a two-year-old, I had a husband to cook for, and I had work. So I said to my employees, let's be clear on goal, and then I trust you to deliver however you want to deliver. And it has paid back the loyalty you get from that. So trust your people and choose your people every single time.
Marvelous advice. Thank you very much. Adrian, quick answer to the great question of advice for folks listening today.
That's brilliant advice. And so I would endorse that and maybe add, I think kind of leading with authenticity and maybe vulnerability. You know, I don't think you know it all in a time like this. I think people respect that, you know, I'm also worried. You know, it's kind of, it's part of being, it's part of trust that you don't know it all. You're just a person who's trying to make your way through this as well. So I'd add to my two colleagues there, great advice, but I would add the intangible nature of collaboration and authenticity. And we're all on the same thing. We're all just people in a complex environment, you know, and get rid of the hierarchy, you know, on the humanity.
Marvelous. I want to thank you all for joining this panel. Adrian, Rundgren, and Priya, thank you so much for your excellent voices on this call. I think we've all come away with some added inspiration, but also some guidance on where we should be focusing. A mentor of mine once said, when times get tough, go up, not down, which was very enigmatic to me at the time. And now I think I get it, right? This idea of going to the real core values and the core things that really bring us together. And thank you for highlighting that so authentically. Iman, I know we could go on all day on this conversation, but we're running out of time. And I think it's time for us to change our focus, actually to double click on this conversation a little bit and take it down into sort of the human capital issues, right?
I think so. I mean, I just have to make an observation. I love what Adrian said at the end there about choosing humanity over hierarchy. And that for me, you know, even as we attempt to flatten the curve of the pandemic, we're also flattening these sort of walls that exist within organizations to let people really make eye contact. And I love that each of our panelists mentioned people. Trust people, choose people, respect people, and more importantly, take people with you. So that was a really brilliant convergence of all of those ideas. And thank you very much to all of our panelists there. So to lead the next panel, I'd like to introduce Vishal Patel. He's Duke's a Global Managing Director for North America. Now, don't let his title fool you. Vishal cut his teeth here in South Africa after joining Duke CE and has also served as the Global Managing Director for Duke CE's Asian business. So Vishal, what we've just been hearing is so important, I think, for our colleagues in HR to think about. We are writing the change that we're going to be talking about decades from now. What are you hearing from our leaders in the human capital space around the world?
Iman, thank you so much for the introduction. It's always great to see you. And I remember us doing this face-to-face, and now being able to do this in a virtual space is fantastic. Look, this pandemic has brought to the forefront our most important asset in any organization, and that is our people. So in the past, we used to talk about how HR was very much around creating a resilient organization. This pandemic has realized that we need to create anti-fragile organizations. What does that mean? That means that if we think about when we start our HR careers, 75% of what we did was about creating stability in the organization, and 25% was around change. That 25% happened every 4 or 5 years with a change in leadership, a change in strategy, and so forth. Right now, it's actually inverted. 75% of what we're doing is really thinking about the constant renewal and rejuvenation of our organization to transform for the future and to be future ready. So I think for us, really what we need to be thinking about is how do we prepare not only for the current reality of what we're doing with the pandemic, but also thinking about what our future organizations look like. What are we doing to create the type of psychological safety, trust, and culture that allows organizations to be sustainable in the future? So with that, sorry, just having a little audio problem. Can you hear me now? No? Yep. Damon, can you hear me? Hello? Iman, can you hear me? It looks like there's a little bit of audio problem that's happening. Yeah, little technical difficulties that happen with any of these events that are out there. So sorry for that. So where we are, coming back into it, we have an incredible panel here to kind of talk through what transformation is going on there. So let me introduce you to this incredible panel. We have Dr. Tokozile Lawanika Papani, who is the head of learning, leadership, and talent for the now Pan-African APSA Bank. We have Dr. Virginia Bastian, who's HR group manager for Nestle Deutschland. We have Lisbeth Nielsen, who's the VPR, HR head of workforce and location strategy for Nokia Europe. We have Shelley Gustafson, who is the chief human resources officer for Jacobs. And then we have Brian Callahan, who's the vice president, resourcing, leadership development, and learning at ArcelorMittal. And lastly, we have, to round out this incredible lineup, we have the head of venture markets, Salwa Amar. So Shelley, I want to start with you. As we are here in this kind of HR landscape, HR has always had a seat at the table, but now you kind of entered this hot seat, right? There have been essentially two positions, I think, that have been elevated up in these pandemics. I think the CFO, managing the financial assets, and your role as managing the human assets that are out there. So from your vantage point, what are you seeing as the most significant change in the role of HR? Shelley?
Thank you, Vishal. It is a hot seat. We often talk about working in a VUCA world, volatile, uncertain, complex, and with a lot of ambiguity. And 2020 is probably VUCA on steroids. The role of HR has been evolving over the course of years, but we've really been thrown into a number of issues that have challenged our organizations, our communities, and frankly, the world. And our business leaders are looking to HR to be partners to bring solutions to help navigate these challenging times. I generally think of sort of three types of HR, and we've played in these three areas for years. But the first, you can think of it on a continuum on the left side, might be the administrative HR. Sort of in the middle is consultative HR, and on the far right is thought leadership HR. And like I said, I think that we play in all three of those areas, but this year we have all been thrown to the far right side to be real thought leaders. So specifically, what has changed? In my world, the speed of decision-making has increased substantially. I think this is a good thing, but it has also been challenging. And so we have to get comfortable with the 80% solution. In our organization, I kind of reflect back on something very early with COVID. We were working on a policy, but we knew it would benefit the organization. And so very quickly, we put it together. I think it took less than 5 minutes to get a decision when something like this would normally take quite a bit of time to vet it. But it was the right thing to do and be comfortable again with an 80% solution. I think we have to be vulnerable as business leaders, admitting that we don't have all the answers right away, but demonstrate that we're committed to working towards solutions. And I know I have reached out to HR colleagues from other organizations to learn from each other. So I think that's changed and is very important at this time. The third item, employees must be heard. We must take action to engage employees and not alienate them, and engage many different constituencies like no time in the past. And last, there is no time like now to amplify our purpose in the organization. Employees are craving for connection and how their work makes a difference. And so I think in the HR organization, we have a responsibility and an obligation to help employees connect to purpose as well.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much, Shelley. I think this idea of getting it 80% is right. We're never going to be in that world anymore. You know, that as Frank and others talked about, we've already made that transition into the future. Dr. Tokozile, maybe this is a little premature for us to be talking about kind of what are the talent priorities post-pandemic, as we're still in the midst of all of these lockdowns, restrictions that are happening around the world that's out there. But I think with your position, you do have a unique insight into that. So what are you seeing, Tokozile, in terms of talent priorities for your business post-pandemic?
I think I'll start by saying the overall talent management objective and priority for the organization hasn't changed, and that is to maintain a future fit workforce. As far as ABSA is concerned, there are two main talent management imperatives in that regard. The first one is to ensure that our people have the mindsets, the behaviors, and the skills that they need in order to deliver, you know, for our customers today and in the future. So we need them to stay future fit in that regard. But secondly, we also feel as an organization that it is incumbent upon us to make sure that our people also remain future fit for the broader world of work. Yeah, so we are working with them for APSA, but then also for the broader world of work. If I had to pick three priorities that stand out for me that we are focusing on in particular, the first one is really around open innovation. So as you will know, the world of work is changing incredibly quickly, and the innovation has moved beyond the typical R&D type processes that we see, and more organizations are waking up to the fact that innovation is the new normal. So accordingly at APSA, we are investing in putting in place new platforms, new processes, building the skills of the broader human capital across the entire organization so that we can unleash the full APSA human quantum brain on our innovation agenda. There isn't any organization that can afford at this time to have its innovation agenda only led by a discrete number of individuals, you know, in some R&D lab, particularly in financial services. If you think about our business, our employees are actually our customers, and they are connected and living within the broader ecosystem of our customers. So open innovation is a very big priority for us at the moment. The second one that has emerged increasingly so because of COVID is about flexible work. The world has changed, our people's lives have changed, and we now need to respond accordingly. So when we are thinking about flexible work, we are reimagining it. It's not just about flexible hours, although that remains important, but it's also about flexible work itself and the nature of work, right? And it's about flexibility to fulfill one's home obligations, because if you think about where our people are working, most of them, 60% of our workforce is still remote. We anticipate that a large part of our workforce will remain remote in a post-COVID world. So we need to make an environment where people can have flexibility as individuals, but also teams, so that our work happens only based on outcomes through these flexible and agile individuals, as well as teams. So that remains a big talent priority. And then the last one that I'll speak about is really around rapid multi-skilling. We've all known for some time now that in a 4IR world, behavioral and leadership skills as important as technical skills. I think what COVID has forced us into has really even raised, you know, the stage of the importance of things like self-autonomy, you know, self-authorship, self-autonomy, because people now have to be much more self-led in the way in which that they do their work. So we're focusing on rapid skilling to make people thrive as remote workers, but we also continue to experiment with things like repurposing people from administrative roles. Now they are cybersecurity professionals so that we avoid disruption. But we also recognize that not every skill that's new that we need is actually a full job, right? And you need to multi-skill the broader workforce as well. So those are the three that I would focus on: open innovation, flexible work, and rapid multi-skilling at scale.
Great, thank you so much, Dokozile. Virginia, I wanna kind of follow up on this idea of flexibility. But before I do that, I'd like to, I think just on behalf of the larger global audience here, just thank Nestle's, I think, ability to kind of help soothe our sweet tooth and kind of give us our own little therapy during the pandemic. A little bit of warmth and sweetness is a very good thing. Your operations are global and differentiated by the regions that are out there. And you need to kind of have this balance between what do you keep flexible further out and what do you keep, you know, central to your core mission. How do you balance and manage your priorities across the business? And what remains constant no matter where you are in the Nestle ecosystem?
That are always relevant, not only in pandemic times that we are facing right now. So I think there is a few things that have to remain at the core, and that has to be absolutely transparent. So it starts with how do we ensure that people priorities are embedded in how we do business, and that we can achieve this by making it absolutely transparent. So when we talk about what is at the core and what is constant, we have different elements of people centricity, like what's the working environment that we are envisioning? What's the nature of our working relationship? What are our core values as a corporation? How do we like reward people? And what is it about people development that we want to like to strive for? Just to name you a few elements. And those sort of elements and people policy in which we have embedded this provides a clear guidance across all of our 80 markets plus that we're operating around the globe. But secondly, as you mentioned rightly, there are also some priorities that might differ because no matter how specific the business strategies are that you have in terms of different markets and different categories, you have to always find a way how you incorporate the people priorities that you have, sort of supporting those local strategies that you have in place. And that's what we're observing right now during the pandemic. You have overall challenges that we'd like to chat, that you'd like to tackle, but at the same time, you have to be very specific what the needs are. So to answer your question, keeping the balance, embed a core that gives you a guidance and sort of relates to what the core of the company is, what you're trying to achieve. And then secondly, ensure whatever the local priorities are, people agenda is always operationalized on the local strategies. And with this, you can guarantee a sort of flexibility to find the right people answers to your strategies locally.
Oh, great. Thank you so much, Virginia. Elizabeth, I want to turn next to you because you're part of an organization that's been around for 160 plus years, which I think a lot of people don't realize. Nokia's just kind of rich, deep history that's there. And at the core of that has been innovation, which means that you have to create that space, as Virginia was talking about, the people strategy, to let people think critically. So a lot of employees have to be managed through this time of change. They may not, you know, have been ready pre-COVID to handle this amazing mishmash of work routines and personal life and childcare and all of those things that are out there. So from your perspective, how do we help people keep the balance when they are working from home, when they have so many other competing priorities, including managing their families, their deadlines, all at the same time? Elizabeth?
Well, thank you for the question. I think it's really relevant. And I think it's a relevant question for many of us at the moment. I think many people are struggling with that. When the pandemic first hit, Nokia went out very quickly to all of the employees and said, the most important thing for us is really your safety of your family. And that actually gave some calmness with the employees and made them relax in a way where they could focus on the thing that was important for them, both the things at home, whether it was practical or emotional things, but also when they had focused on that, it allowed them to actually focus on the work, which of course then turns out to be a win-win both from a company perspective. As you brought up in your question, Nokia have a long history and been through many, many, many changes over the years. And that of course also means employees are used to a high degree of time. And we see that also in situations like this, that their ability to handle a difficult situation actually are paying off. We also have been used to working very, very flexible. So the change of going home to work from home have not been that big problem in many ways. So we have that flexibility in how you work and at what time hours. What we see coming more as a question, and I think as a community in general, as a community we need to work with, is actually the well-being and the mental health. Because this, of course, is a big stress situation. And it's been going on for a while, and we expect it to go on for a while more. And what we do is we try really and talk. So we talk openly about it on the Nokia level, and we talk open about it with employees, between time managers and employees and in teams, about the stress and the difficulties of handling situations. We also have very practical personal support, for example, where employees can talk. People who are not Nokia people actually get support and really confidential.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you, Elizabeth. I think this idea of health and wellness, let's come back to that in a little bit, because I think that's critical, because we have to see the whole person, as Shelley and others were talking about, you know, see the whole person and engage where they are and make sure that you hear them. Brian, I want to turn to you because You sit in an interesting place, right? So ArcelorMittal is the largest steelmaker in the world, has incredibly global operations, but that are very complicated, right? We talked about safety and other things already that are out there. Literally, those are at the forefront of what you're doing. As an organization that has such a large global reach, how do you manage this high-performance culture during this pandemic time, right? And what have you potentially learned that you can apply post-pandemic, Brian?
Thank you, Vishal. Well, the question suggests that remote working requires major actions to keep or reach a high performance culture. But what factor of working physically close to one another is creating that culture? Is it control? Is it the possibility to intervene when a team member goes off track? We've heard about trust today. Trust might be the key word here. When there is no trust, remote working will always be seen as a threat to high performance. A leader's behavior should not fundamentally change whether an employee is working in the office, in a hotel room, on a plane, or from their home. Most of my team work in locations different from mine. There are some basic principles that should be applied wherever a person is working. Firstly, we need to recognize that productivity improvement from remote working is real. Feedback from employees and leaders during this pandemic is overwhelmingly positive about the benefits and productivity improvements from working from home. This includes many skeptics that were not convinced about working from home before we were asked to do so by governments. We should be results oriented. Time in the office is not a representation of results. Clear short-term and long-term objectives linked to business priorities, productivity measures, KPIs, should be agreed with each employee, independent of where they're working. And of course, it's essential that good communication is maintained at all times. Increasing the frequency of progress reviews will ensure alignment and focus, building that high-performance culture. But at the end of the day, it's the leader's attitudes and behavior that will have the greatest influence on the climate and the creation of a high-performance culture. Leaders need to be positive, create an environment in which employees are engaged and motivated. They should communicate clearly, consistently, setting out the direction and expectations of their teams. They should create a workplace based on continuous learning that supports employees' resilience and capacity to adapt. They need to trust and empower their teams, knowing that they're capable of being productive, and have faith to let them do their work. And of course, they must hold their teams accountable for results and recognize and reward high performance.
No, excellent. Thank you so much. This theme of continuous learning is probably a really good segue, Salwa, into kind of what you're seeing as the head of New Venture Markets for LinkedIn Learning. I often think about LinkedIn as kind of, we used to the future movie reference earlier, it's almost like The Matrix, right? You're seeing in real time what the different generations are looking for, right, as they're on this continuous learning journey. So what are the trends that you're seeing? What are you seeing in particular with Gen Z during this period?
Vishal, it's a great question. So this year, Gen Z will be joining the workforce, bringing with them a brand new set of skills, backgrounds, education. And as a result, talent developers and HR professionals are faced with the challenge of engaging four generations at the same time: Gen Z, Millennials, Gen X, and Boomers. To help understand multi-generation learners' engagement, especially Gen Z, we tap into over 6 million LinkedIn members globally to better understand the capabilities they have, skills they need, and courses they are taking. And the data on multi-generational learner reveals three trends that I'm going to call. First trend is that Gen Z show a high proficiency in hard skills and technical skills. 50% of their top 10 skills were in that area, and 30% of their shared skills were focused on programming languages. They bring a lot of necessary hard competency into their organization, and talent developers think that Gen Z will need more work and development on people skills. The second trend is that Gen Z and other generation of learners have much more in common than what we think. They have shared with us their top 10 courses, and the one taken by all of them on LinkedIn Learning was Body Language for Leaders. Surprising. And the third and last trend is that Gen Z has come to the workplace and they're trying to learn how to both obtain a job and perform well in it. So according to the survey, 35% of them want to learn in order to impress their boss. And some of them are worried that they won't be able to do so. So because they want to learn how to make a good impression, we saw them learning a lot on topics like giving your elevator pitch and body language for leaders among their top 10 courses. So to summarize, there's one common trend that spans all generation anyway, the desire to develop and grow. So with four generations now in the workplace, each with a unique set of skills and learning needs, talent developers have a unique and incredible opportunity to make an impact in their organizations by complementing each other.
I will finish by saying that our mission at LinkedIn is to create an economic opportunity to every member of the workforce. So we support all generations, especially Gen Z, to grow and thrive by publishing on a regular basis insight about most in-demand jobs, most in-demand skills, and we open free learning content to our members to help them to achieve their goals. And we are proud to do that and to bring our contribution for a better world.
Excellent. So I want to, in our remaining time, kind of come back to something Elizabeth was mentioning and connect with what Saul was saying here around continuous learning and also this idea of health and wellness being seeing the whole person on where they are. So Shelley, I'll go to you first. How have you, what has changed in the focus on health and well-being during this pandemic? And what do you think is going to stay with Jacobs going forward?
Yeah, so Jacobs is a global company with a workforce of 50,000 employees around the world. We have referred to our culture as a culture of caring for a number of years, and that really started with a strong focus on safety. And then, a couple of years ago, we added to that mental health because we really recognized you have to have the whole person engaged and being present in the organization. And so prior to COVID, we actually trained over 1,500 mental health champions within Jacobs to be a point of contact. They don't diagnose, they don't advise, but they listen. And with COVID, we have taken this to the next level. About 2 weeks ago, we kicked off a campaign, not only internal to Jacobs, but externally as well. And we call it 1 Million Lives. And it's an app for our employees, their family members, and again, people around the world to do a mental health check-in. Our goal is to create a ripple effect across the globe where over 1 million people are inspired to complete a mental health check-in and to help break down barriers that hinder honest conversations about mental health and encourage an open culture of support. So I think that we will continue that journey because we've recognized that mental health is critical to employee engagement, productivity, and thriving in the organization.
Yeah, no, thank you for that, Shelley. Regina, you had talked about kind of people priorities and kind of operationalizing that. Where have you seen health and well-being kind of play in the people priority space at Nestle?
Well, I think it's similar to what Shelley just shared. So it has always been on the agenda. And with the fact that we are having 60-70% of our workforce working in factory environment, the aspect of safety becomes even more relevant. And what we're seeing right now during the pandemic, so it has been there on the agenda already, but I think now the focus is sort of supplemented by other aspects. So mental health, I think, is something to focus on. But I think if we talk about well-being, it's also something about the nest warmth, if I can call it like that, because due to the fact that people are not seeing each other so often anymore, that for line managers, they're not as close anymore to their teams. That is something that we would have to find a way to address those needs and help our leaders, especially to build competencies, but also programs and mechanisms to bring this human factor, which is a tremendous part of well-being of our employees in the company, more in these times, especially.
Yeah, that's excellent. Tokazile, I want to end with you around the health and wellness being and this human factor that Virginia was talking about. Can you describe some of the programs or different initiatives that APSA has undertaken?
Thanks, Vishal. I think I'll mention two. I think the first thing that happened in APSA, and it evolved quite naturally, was the first time we had a very strict national lockdown in South Africa. We started a workplace group called Lockdown Diaries. So Lockdown Diaries, which is, it's on Workplace, which is like Facebook for organizations. And this became a platform for human connection and storytelling. And one would find on the platform, there'll be inspiring stories, there would be sad stories. But what was great is that there was always connection. And what happened was after the lockdown regulations were a bit eased, we transformed that group from Lockdown Diaries, we now call it Stories to Share, because we actually realized that we need to turn positive storytelling, which helps one build resilience and hope, right? And that's very important for emotional and mental resilience, is this learned optimism. We realized that this platform actually sustains an organizational conversation, an organization storytelling, which as you know, is really core to our African culture. So I would say this is something that we are looking to really embed across the organization around positive storytelling. And positive storytelling doesn't mean happy stories, right? Positive storytelling means stories that people can connect to, whether they're sad stories or whether they're inspiring stories. So that's one very big one. And then the second quick one that I'll mention that I think other people could also learn from is that we've started to approach our physical, mental, and emotional well-being as something that we engage all our colleagues on simultaneously. So we have these mass, whether it's mindfulness sessions or whether it's like a fitness burst, we encourage our colleagues to bring their family along, you know, on the screen and to participate. And I think this is something that many organizations should also take forward as we are intentional, you know, about working together and producing great work. We should also be intentional about coming together to produce great bodies, great minds, and great hearts, because all of that is necessary for high performance.
Now, excellent, Tokozile. I could talk to you all for another hour or so, but I'm sure Iman and others, we have other panelists to get to. So let me first of all say thank you so much for the panelists for your incredible insight that's out there. We started this conversation talking about how you're very much in that hot seat on what's happening in your organizations, but this frankly has never been a better time, because the human capital conversation is very much around how do we accelerate and transform the organizations that we're in? And thank you for sharing your insights. The one key thing that in all of our prep work until now is that no one has all of the right answers, right? But collectively, we do have a spirit that we can unlock what's best for our people, society, and have that decency quotient that Dean Boulding was mentioning earlier, just for the larger world that's out there. So Iman, I'm gonna turn it back over to you, and thank you for letting us have this conversation.
Thanks so much, Vishal. I think what's most exciting for me is how the respect and care for human resources has become so much more focused. It is a quantum leap forward for how people work and are valued, I'm sure. And as one of your panelists said, we should be more outcome orientated, that our presence in the office is not a representation of results. So sign me up, because I'm all in for that concept. What's remarkable about all of our conversation pieces today is just how the theme of common sense is a common theme throughout. Remember that all of our conversation pieces from today can be found on our Duke CE website. I am sure that you're going to want to meditate on this a little bit more. The Davos of Human Capital 2020 is almost over. And as we look back at this year and recall all the ways that we tried to rise to the challenges of a changing world, we have a lot to think about. Who each of us is becoming is likely going to be reframed as who we were before COVID-19. And who we are after COVID-19. But before we say goodbye to everyone, I'd like to bring back Shamla Chetty. Shamla, this has been such an invigorating session. What are your closing thoughts?
Iman, thank you so much. What an amazing session with such great insights and thought leadership. Firstly, let me pay tribute to the great minds who have contributed to our Leadership for a Better World conversation. Our Dean Boulding set the context of why business must be a force for good. We need empathy, understanding. He talked about the triple threat leader, why decency quotient is more critical now than ever. Frank illustrated how we fast forwarded and how we need to embrace the new reality and act now, and how to build a culture of empathy. I'm reminded that we have a responsibility as leaders, because we have access, we have authority, and we have influence. As Adrian Gore shared, the private sector can play a massive role in good of society. We need moral leadership, moral courage at a time like this. Our leadership panel told us today the biggest lesson is to trust our people. Choose people, respect people. We can pivot our business for good. It is our responsibility. We must remind ourselves that no one is safe until everyone is safe. Our society needs business leaders to show boundless empathy, compassion, and why trust is critical now more than ever before. Purpose matters. Professor Dan Ariely shared with us what motivates us. I love this, you know, how we treat women, you know, and he talked about having the right direction, inclusiveness, feeling appreciated. People feel the company will care for them. And this, you know, being that translates to motivation. The increased value of independence as people, organization, and society, humanity has never been more important than ever. In Africa, there is a strong value from Ubuntu. It teaches us, I am because of you. You cannot go far unless we go together. So thank you everyone for joining us. A huge thank you. And most importantly, stay safe and build a better world. And goodbye and thank you.
Shamna, thank you very much to you and the entire team at Duke CE around the world. It has been a pleasure being with you today. Stay safe and hopefully we see you all again at Davos 2021.